applications in the geosciences, and that's a pretty big deal as well. So Ellen is going to talk to us about a really exciting topic. One of the reasons it's exciting is that the Ocean Drilling Program, or the International Ocean Discovery Program, as it's now called, is right now tripping pipe at the Chicxulub Impact Crater to try to understand more about the KT boundary and the impact that it had. And we're going to learn a little bit more about that and some other things right now. So welcome, Ellen.
Thank you, Amelia, for... So when I was asked to talk in some feature mentioning extreme events, I started to think about what were the most extreme events in the kind of things I've been working on, and you see them right there. Basically, my talk is going to be very similar to the last talk in one aspect, and that is that I'll talk about life in the oceans on various timescales and their variability. It's just that when our timescales get longer, then we have a bigger chance of getting much larger deviations from normal, right? And so the things that I see as extreme events are really kind of unusual and did not happen as we can be very happy in our lifetime. Or did they? Or will they? Let me get this thing. So I will talk about asteroid impact, carbon cycle upheaval. And to put my timescales in perspective, after just talking on human timescales, I will talk about timescales that vary from really, really fast, instantaneous, to what us geologists consider really, really fast, and that is thousands of years. So although the events I'm talking about are millions and tens of millions of years in the past, I will talk about the events as happening on a much shorter timescale. And if we look at our fossil fuel burning, then that is somewhere kind of in-between-ish. Okay, so first, I didn't know what Amelia was going to say, so I'll talk a little bit about what I do, so you get an idea about what my perspective on things is. And my perspective is always the perspective of benthic foraminifera, which are, of course, the most fascinating organisms in the world. Sorry, all you other people. However, I find out that if I tell the National Science Foundation that I need money to study foraminifera because they are the most fascinating organisms in the world, they are not convinced. So I have to think of some other ideas. And so the first thing is, if you look at microscopic fossils, then of course each sample has lots of specimens, and I can talk about life in the past on a more or less statistical valid way. If you're doing dinosaurs, it's really, really hard to get a whole population of dinosaurs. So my forams are unicellular eukaryotes, what we used to call protists, nowadays Rhizaria, and I count, in essence, morphological species. And so I don't do really difficult things, I count till 300, that's what I do. And the ones I specialize in are deep sea benthic forams that live on the deep sea floor. And so then you can make the argument that if you look at the evolution, extinction, and diversity of life, as proxied by foraminifera, on the deep sea floor, then you get information on the largest habitat on Earth, and so things that affect deep sea habitats, in essence, are truly global. And so this is one of my favorite cartoons from the New Yorker, in which some people are saying, I don't know why I don't care about the bottom of the ocean, but I don't, which is, I think, in general, the idea of many people in the general public. I don't think that you over here feel like that. And maybe those people would have felt different if they had only known about foraminifera. And so if you talk about paleoceanography and oceanic ecosystems of the past, not only are we talking about deep sea benthic forams, we're also talking about their counterparts in the plankton, zooplankton, and calcareous nanoplankton that are calcifiers that photosynthesize, that live in the surface waters, let's call them for that. We talk about metazoa and ostracodes, small crustaceans that live on the deep sea floor. All those things make calcium carbonate skeletons. And so if we look at the morphological species and we count species, look at abundance and so, we get information on what species, how diverse. We compare them with a living relative, which tells us something about the environment, how and where in the water column do they live, what do they tell us about nutrients, upwelling food supply. And at the same time, we can actually take their poor little carbonate skeletons and dissolve them in phosphoric acid and analyze them for the trace element and isotopic compositions of the shells, which provides us information on parameters of the environment. And so, what does convince the National Science Foundation is if you make the argument that on the same samples, we get information on biota of some form, as well as on their environment, and so we can try and make a linkage between changes in the environment and what happens to the biota on a relatively large scale. So step two of what I do is I use the calcium carbonate in foraminiferal shells for stable isotopic analysis of the workhorses in paleoceanography, carbon and oxygen isotopes, as well as trace element analysis such as strontium, magnesium, a new proxy iodine and boron, as proxies for such environmental parameters as temperature, salinity, volume of the polar ice sheets, oxygen levels, pH, primary productivity, and ocean circulation patterns. So that's a lot of stuff that you can get out of microscopic shells. And so again, to repeat this, we can directly compare the data on changes in living things through species counts, abundance counts, with data on the environment in which they live. And that's more or less what we call paleoceanography. So you get information about the oceans and biota in the past. I'm not going to bore you too much with this. This is just, again, one of those convincing slides to show what all we can do. You have the atmosphere, you have the bottom of the ocean, everything in between, the pelagic world, the benthic world. There is photosynthesis going on, productivity, the biological pump brings organic matter to the seafloor. And there is this whole battery of different things that we can try and measure either on calcareous shells or in organic molecules in the water column and in the sediments to tell us about their environment. And there's lots of different factors in the environment that we can try to get information on from all those various proxies. So again, how do we get our material for study? And this also ranges from amazingly low-tech to pretty high-tech, the International Ocean Discovery Program. This is my husband and a couple of students pushing a Dutch corer. I'm from Holland originally, so there's a Dutch corer, to get a core of peat formed close to the coast, or the coastal salt marshes of Connecticut. And we use benthic foraminifera to work out rates of sea level rise over the last, say, 1 or 2,000 years. This is us with a technician coring in on Block Island, actually, and trying very hard for our boat not to hit the yacht of Jimmy Buffett, who is several millions dollars. And getting some cores from Block Island Sound and Long Island Sound. And again, you don't have to do organic carbon analysis to see that the sediment is olive green at the bottom and black at the top. And so this is eutrophication and increased organic carbon as the result of increased human populations in the area. And then finally, here is the International Ocean Discovery Program and things I'll be talking about today. This is a deep sea core in which the color reflects calcium carbonate concentration. And again, you don't have to analyze this for calcium carbonate percentage to see that there's high calcium carbonate with the light color at the back and then a certain strong decrease in percentage of 8% calcium carbonate in the core. So, if you want to know about climate of the past, then if you go to Google, Bing, Wikipedia, etc., then in many cases you see some kind of picture like this. And you see the Cenozoic era, in which I put the extinction of the dinosaurs, and then you see something called global surface temperature, or something like that. And then you see here, of course, business as usual predictions for the future, Antarctic ice sheets, northern hemispheric ice sheets, long-term cooling trend, etc. And so then the question is, which those of you who have read the paper that Amelia was talking about immediately know is, you know, where does this plot come from? Since in many cases, if you go Wikipedia, Google, Bing, etc., they show you this picture and they don't say where it comes from. So, you know, how the heck do you know that? And of course, this is the famous plot that Amelia was talking about. This is from a 2001 paper, by now way outdated, and you should cite something else, in which time goes vertically. And this is again the end of the Cretaceous, the KPG, as we call it these days, extinction of the dinosaurs and other things. And this is the so-called Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum, about 10 million years later. So we talk about 65 and 55 million years ago. What we're plotting on this, what those data points actually are, you can see the places where we don't have too many data, so they all overlap. There's actually little pluses here. And so each of the little pluses is the dissolution of 15 to 20 poor benthic foraminifera for doing oxygen isotope analysis in that test. So you dissolve the calcium carbonate and you analyze for the isotopic composition, specifically 18O, 16O. Whenever this curve goes to the left, we plot those things the wrong way around, the values go heavier. And this means either that the temperature was getting lower, it was getting colder, or the ice caps were growing in size. And I'll not talk about the details of why this is, but because of the global distribution of precipitation and Rayleigh fractionation during evaporation and precipitation, the precipitation has the lightest O18, the lightest delta O18 values at the poles, and so our polar ice caps are isotopically light. If we put a lot of the light isotopes on land in the ice caps, the oceans get heavier. You can put stuff only in one place. That is one effect. The other effect is the temperature effect. And so if you go back far enough in time that we think we had no appreciable ice caps at the poles, we can use this as a temperature effect. And so if you look at this temperature scale at about this part of the time, geological time, then you can see that deep sea temperatures were on the order of about 10 degrees C, which is, let's say, about 10 degrees C higher than it is today. And so for everyone who works with organisms in the oceans, you know that if you increase the temperature by 10 degrees C, we're talking about very different metabolic rates and very different processes than today. That's a warning. Okay, then look at the carbon isotopes. After all, if you look at calcium carbonate, we have carbon as well as oxygen. And so we can also look at the carbon isotopic data in calcium carbonate. And if you look at where the Earth's carbon is, it's in many different places, from carbonate rocks to coal measures to oil and gas and vegetation and dissolved inorganic carbon and all those kind of different reservoirs. And the carbon, as you know, it cycles between all those reservoirs on different timescales. And during this cycling through the various reservoirs, the largest fractionation is because of photosynthesis, so that everything plant and everything that eats plant is isotopically much lighter, say minus 22, minus 25, than the reservoir atmospheric CO2 from which the carbon is actually sequestered in the organic matter. And so in essence, you can follow what, for instance, people eat by analyzing themselves for their carbon isotopes. And so this is done often industrially, for instance. If someone says this beer is made with the purest hops, and in reality they put corn in it, you analyze them for their carbon isotope composition and you find that out. And so a lot of this is done industrially. A lot of this is done ecologically to figure out which specific organisms eat. And, you know, you are what you eat, which sounds much better in German. And so if we look at how much carbon on a global scale is stored in those different reservoirs, we can actually say something about the isotopic composition of the CO2 in the atmosphere. So if, same as with the ice, if you put the lighter isotope with ice, O16, on the ice caps, the oceans get heavier. If we put the lighter isotope in organic matter and in fossil fuel for that matter, then we take away the light isotope from the atmosphere and stuff it in the lithosphere. And so what we do by fossil fuel burning is, in essence, another word for adding isotopically light carbon to the ocean atmosphere system. And so this is a kind of involved plot. What they show over here is PCO2 in the atmosphere going the wrong way around, so it gets higher if you go down. And that's those little bubbly things here. And that show increasing PCO2. And since we burn fossil fuel, which is organic matter, which is isotopically light, not only are we changing the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, we're changing its carbon isotopic composition. And so again, anyone as this must be volcanic carbon, is obviously wrong, because volcanic carbon would not change the isotopic composition of the atmosphere. Sorry, Florida. And so if you then look at the carbon isotopic composition of various carbonates, then we see this carbonate formed in the oceans reflecting the atmospheric signature. Okay, to get back to our various episodes in Earth's history, let's start by talking shortly about asteroid impact. This is, you know, from all the natural processes going on, is the one that is faster than us humans, right? So asteroid impacts is fast on a human timescale, really fast. And so as everyone, I suppose, kind of knows, because everyone knows their dinosaurs and things like that, in contrast to the much more interesting foraminifera, if we have an asteroid impact on the Yucatan Peninsula, and this was linked to a mass extinction of various estimates to 50 or 75% of all species, including things as dinosaurs on land and such things as mosasaurs in the oceans. And mosasaurs are kind of big lizards. I don't know if you know about the mosasaur, but the original mosasaur, named after the river, was described from my own country, the Netherlands. And the original skull was stolen by Napoleon when he actually conquered the Netherlands. And his scientists took the original mosasaur skull to Paris, and they still have not given it back. You're still complaining about it. They sent us a copy. However, the mosasaurs went extinct at the end of the Cretaceous. And so did the ammonites, which are things they were eating. And if you look at the number of different places on the world ocean where we have found the records of this impact event, then people have made the distinction. This is from Schulte et al. In Science in 2010. Those are a number of different sites. And at the proximal sites, like on Cuba, you find actually masses of disturbed sediment. If you throw great big asteroids in the ocean, you disturb a lot of sediment. And you find disturbed sediment up till 100, 150 meter thick masses on Cuba, for instance. In Mexico, that's proximal, those same masses of disturbed sediment or tsunami deposits are, say, 5 to 20 meters thick. If you go further away, they get thinner and thinner, and we find relatively centimeter thick layers. I'll show you the record from somebody here, which is intermediate, which was recovered by ocean drilling. This is actually, I saw somewhere in the building I saw this. This is from a poster of the Smithsonian. And so this is the site of North America, the Smithsonian Museum exhibit. And here is my carbonate ooze of the Cretaceous age. And then here you have this layer, which at this place is like 15 centimeters thick, of some mixture of material blasted from the crater. And there's hardly anything left from the factor. If you look at this kind of material, it's about 97-98% of material from the target, that is the Earth's crust, that is vaporized and then recondenses. And then here you have the end of that with the finest stuff from the fallout. And here you go on, and you go back to the lowermost Cretaceous, and you see what things are left over. If you look at foraminifera, then the Cretaceous foraminifera are those diverse and, for foraminifera, kind of large objects. The scale here is the same. Then here we have those little spherules, which is molten silicate material that condenses in the atmosphere. And then here we have the foraminifera that were partially surviving and partially evolving anew. And so if you look at just your Cretaceous Paleogene fauna and floral records, this is a typical example in which you find lots of things in the Cretaceous. Then you find things dominated by a few survivor species, disaster species that bloom. And then you're starting to see evolution of new things. And so, as such, the foraminiferal records were much clearer than the dinosaur or the ammonite records in showing that this is a sudden event. Because if you don't find any dinosaurs, that doesn't tell you anything, right? Because even at the time the dinosaurs were alive, there are many more places where there are no dinosaurs, bones, than there are places where there are dinosaurs. So the absence of dinosaurs doesn't tell you anything. If you have something like foraminifera or calcareous nanoplankton, that is a rock-forming kind of organism, the absence does tell you something. And so it's easier to establish that something is a fast event if you look at the marine record. However, and this is an important point, for the calcareous nanoplankton, the phytoplankton and the zooplankton, 95 to 97% of the species went extinct. Globally, only 3 species of planktic forams survived. However, benthic forams did not go extinct. In fact, if you look at your population diversity and abundances, statistically, there is no significant difference before the Cretaceous-Tertiary boundary and afterwards. And so you would say, well, you know, those things live in the deep ocean, so, you know, sure, of course, they didn't notice. However, that's not the way things would work in the deep sea oceans, as pretty much everyone here knows, I'm sure. The deep sea is very, very poor in food. So here are some of my forams made more personal by Gerhard Schmiedel, who really likes foraminifera. And they don't have those cute little faces in real life, unfortunately. But so they live, what this shows very nicely is that they live on top of the sediment and inside the sediment. We have epifaunal, infaunal things. And how much you have each type tells you something about the flux of organic matter from the surface. Because in the deep sea, of course, we have no photosynthesis. And so those poor things are largely dependent on the puny